Good afternoon, and thank you for being here. The G20 session is just over. It was a very useful session, a time for change, I think. And the most important decision that was made is that, given the relevance of digital government, the transition from a task force carrying out studies and analysis has now become a permanent group with its own project, which is a very important because it means that the G20 governments recognized that we need a new way of a new governance of the digital world. And it means that they recognize the relevance of sharing experience, sharing lessons, sharing practices. The pillar of this initiative, well, we have identified three of them. First of all, digital identity. Digital identity is of paramount importance. As you know, in Italy, we are not starting from scratch. We have about 45 million in between electronic identity card and digital identities. We are going on. We believe that this experience should be further extended and disseminated at international level. Of course, it is going to be a daunting task, a big effort, but the importance of the digital green certificate has shown that the time has come for us to think about international connections as far as digital identity is concerned. Second pillar is the sharing of all our experiences when it comes to services to our societies. There have been various experiments going on, more or less successful. Of course, we have to continue discussing with each other, but we have to be more oriented to sharing these practices. And last but not least, agile regulation. That's the third pillar. It is a new way of it's a new way of regulation. I'm really a supporter of these agile regulation. We can't use the same method that we adopted in the past. We have to be more agile, swifter. We have to use regulatory sandboxes. We have to experiment with legislation. It is a very important issue, and indeed we want agile regulation to be one of our pillars. It has been a very successful G20 meeting. Minister Giorgetti and Undersecretary Ascani have then referred to other topics. We have an 11-page report with many actions, many projects, many decisions that we believe will be further implemented by successive presidencies. This is my summary. The declaration will be published on the G20 website, and I think I'm ready to take your questions. Good evening, Minister, from Sky G24. I can't hear you very well. Could you please move further away from the microphone? Is it better? Barbato, Sky TG24. What happened in the Lazio region could realistically happen elsewhere in other regions? And then when you refer to the public, to the civil service, saying that there is a lack of security, exactly when do you think security will be implemented 100%? Well, I have to tell you something. I don't know anything specific about what is going on, what has happened in Lazio. So I would not comment on the situation in Lazio and the cyber attacks that have been taking place over the last couple of days. Clearly, the more you resort to digital services, the higher the level of security has to be. It can happen in other regions, it can happen elsewhere, but I believe that all over the world, in Europe and in Italy, we're witnessing an increase of cyber attacks, force ransomware rather than violation of personal data. which is not better anyway. So the risk is there. The risk is everywhere in the world. And I believe that over the last few hours, all those in charge of IT services, both privately and publicly, are reviewing their own systems to increase the level of security. I believe that this event has shown us three things. First of all, that the small size doesn't help. We have to enlarge the size, the dimension of our data center, thereby achieving a scale that allows us to have a very effective protection. Secondly, we have to improve organizational processes and controls, as it already happens in the private world. We have to have a culture of security also in the civil service, in the public administration. We have to have tests, self-hacking tests, controls to verify how secure our processes are. And thirdly, we have to accelerate when it comes to the cloud environment. Cloud provides us with a better resilience. How long will it take? Well, we are working a lot. We are thinking about a national cloud project. The project will be launched soon. Migration to the cloud will take a little longer. But we are indeed involving all peripheral local authorities so that they can get on board. Good evening. Beniamino Pagliaro, Repubblica. In the light of the nature of the G20, how complex is it going to be to have a real digital identity system in all G20 countries? The G20 comprises very different countries. So which is going to be the key to ensure that those freedoms that maybe we take for granted in the Western world are not going to be violated in other countries? And given that you refer to digital economy, one of the successes of the G20, the finance G20 that took place in Venice, has to do with the digital tax. So taxing the multi-tech giant and multinationals. Are countries supporting this proposal of a digital tax or not? I'll start with the second part of your question. As you rightly said, it is not a digital tax. It's a tax on multinationals. And of course, this is a topic that finance ministers deal with it, so we didn't discuss it here in Trieste. As for the first part of your question, clearly there are different systems in the world, which doesn't mean that regionally we cannot be more ambitious and start working together. But think, for instance, well, I remember very clearly when Roberto Viola, general manager in Europe, called me one evening. And he said, there is a big project. We have to implement it by June. And I answered, we'll never go into make it 27 countries, technological innovation. And still we are here. The time is ripe. At least we have to start regionally, at continental level, at subcontinental level. This is what we have to start doing. We have to create these interoperable platforms. And then the underlying systems will remain the same. They will not be changed. But I think that we are making step forwards, step by step, step by step.
Daniele Zaino, Corriere della Sera. You talked about international regulation.
So I'll go back to the previous question. From the viewpoint of regulation, are there going to be substantial differences among the different countries? There are countries which are not very much democratic when adopted legislations, and there are other countries which instead have much greater respect to individual freedoms. There have been problems with China and with Russia, for instance.
When you talk about regulation, I'd like to know whether you also refer to the possibility to create new international institutional levels when it comes to digital governance. Maybe a new level within the United Nations for digital governance. The answer is no, but we discussed about different platforms and different fora where we can continue debating this problem. As for artificial intelligence, the architecture of ethics of artificial intelligence is being discussed in Europe. It's being discussed within the OECD and in other venues. And all these debates and discussions have highlighted certain problems in the light of the membership of each organization. We didn't discuss about new institutional levels, new institutional organizations. I've quoted the example of artificial intelligence because maybe that's the first example that comes to our mind because of its ethical and legal implications. So discussions, platforms, but no new international levels. As for the digital identity and interoperability of services, clearly the underlying systems remain the same. But this holds true also for when you apply for a passport. The systems are basically the same, but we recognize passports all over the world. So there can be a frictionless recognition of our systems, a swifter recognition, without the unduly slow pace that sometimes we see. Certain digital features and certain digital documents, are they going to be released and granted? It depends on the system. Individual systems of the individual countries, but I saying that the European example and the Italian example for the green certificate show us that it can be done in a very short period of time. This has been another topic that we have mentioned repeatedly from all over the world, from America to Asia to Africa. The common remark was that thanks to the pandemic, we've discovered that we can do a lot more things digitally than we thought in the past. Now we have three priorities: stability of what we have achieved, dissemination of the application, reaching out to new societies and communities, and services. This, I think, is the most important message that we have conveyed when it comes to mutual learning. Now we have to further deepen what we have achieved. But the underlying systems, I repeat it, will stay the same. Good evening. Bonifazio from ANSA. Did you also discuss about infrastructure? Did you share the different model infrastructures, I mean, concessions or co-investment with a private-public partnership? Was the Italian experience mentioned in this field? Were there similar experiences to the Italian one? Did you mention the wholesale networks or vertical networks? Well, connectivity has been touched upon, so the answer is yes, of course. And connectivity, wideband and ultra-wideband connectivity, is seen by all countries, regardless of their degree of development, as very important. We did not enter into very specific details. We did not mention the national setup systems, so we did not enter into the details of the models. But there will be a public consultation, a consultation with the public very soon on this. I think you can just make your question. There's another question, second round of questions. My colleague just a while ago mentioned regulation. Over the last few weeks, the steps taken by China have been rather worrying, and even the Stock Exchange Security Commission was rather worried. You have seen the growth of innovative companies in your career. Which is the right approach that one should take? Well, we did not talk about the Chinese declarations or actions or steps. Certainly, we discussed about how having a kind of regulation that can foster innovation, especially innovation in the small and medium-sized companies, which is something that is very important for us, not just for me, but for Minister Giorgetti too. How can we ensure that innovation is just reserved for large companies? We talked about clouds. This is a project where we're banking on. We're really hopeful that it is going to be a very successful project, and possibly over and above hope, we will also invest money in that project. We really want to create a safe and secure environment in Europe for the benefit especially of SMEs, because large companies can survive without that project, but SMEs can find new areas of data economy that they can explore, that they can experiment with, and I'm sure there will be excellence, points of excellence. Together with Minister Giorgetti of Economic Development, we have established an informal connection among all these topics, clouds, digital identity, and so on and so forth. And I think that other countries are indeed exploring the same possibilities. I'm personally convinced that regulation should be shorter, should adopt a shorter cycle. We would have to have more rapid interactions. And I believe that the model of exemptions, of sandboxes, of experimental authorizations is fundamental, especially when it comes to the digital transformation. And I hope that we are going to be able to adopt this model as soon as possible. Last question? No, last but one. Raffaella Bruno, Sky News. Now, going back to digital security, Minister Giorgetti today told us that the government is working to improve security. Do you have some more details to provide us with? And don't you think that the government should maybe invest more resources in this domain? So it's going to be the last question. It's a very good question, but now I'm getting very enthusiastic, because this is a topic that I've really insisted on for many years. And I think that this government has taken very important steps. First of all, we want to create an agency for cybersecurity. What is an agency for cybersecurity? It is a body which doesn't belong to the service compartment, but it belongs to national security services. It will help private and public companies and institutions to stay safe and secure. We have reorganized the system. All specific skills and competencies will be grouped within this agency. We have assigned and allotted resources to this agency. We are working together with this agency, my ministry in particular, to produce data certification procedures so as to better define how data should be treated in Italy. And we're also working on a definition of service providers. We are really working on it, and very soon we will see the results. So basically, we are bridging the existing gap. And within 6 to 12 months, we are making up for the time we lost in a couple of years. I think this is the most important thing that we are doing. Minister Giorgetti has invested resources. When you said that more money should be invested, I mean, there are 600 million within the National Plan for Recovery and Resilience. But this is not the most important thing. We need software engineers that have to do deep software inspection to ensure that hospitals, that the manufacturing industries, that banks really receive the help that they need when necessary, or the region, as we have seen in the Lazio region over the last couple of days. So it's a problem of resources and skills, not so much money. I'm sure that if money is going to be necessary, I'm sure that money will be found. But it's more human resources and skills that we need. And indeed, I'm very happy that we're going to hire young people, women and men, within this agency. There will be a lot to do because, as we've seen, cyber attacks are increasing. It is not a matter of money. It's a matter of resources and skills. And Mr. Gabrielli is working on this. Very recently, the U.S. have, after blaming Russia, for certain cyber attacks, the U.S. have been indirectly blaming China as well. So you discuss about cybersecurity within the G20. Which kind of environment, of climate, do you have when you discuss these topics? Because the U.S. and China and Russia delegations, they have attended this meeting. I think you know the answer already. It's not our competence and it's not our duty to discuss these topics. It has to do, it involves foreign affairs ministry or other authorities. So we did not discuss these topics, and it would have been useless because there are many other ideas and initiatives that are much more useful when it comes to cooperation. The real topic, going back to the question of your predecessor, is not so much to understand where these threats and attack come from, but rather having the necessary infrastructures and defense infrastructure that can protect us. Now, we are worried about sovereign attacks and threats, but there are other attacks and threats that are not sovereign, and they are as dangerous as the others. So we have to have the necessary defense tools. And then these defense tools will be used against the attackers. But what we are doing, we're doing it with the clouds, with the strategic plan that we have for public administration. We are raising our level of defense against all types of attacks. And then it will be up to the other ministers to decide precisely against whom. Thank you. Thank you for your questions. Enjoy your weekend and your holidays.